there's something that's been called a reproducibility crisis. So reproducibility is a hallmark of good science. What do we mean by this? Basic things like you can reproduce the results under the same conditions. So for example, water boils at 100 degrees Celsius if you're at a pressure of 101.325 kilopascals. Right? And that, you try that in anywhere and it should work. But the scientific community has been recognizing there is a crisis in recent years of reproducibility. The many published scientific findings are actually false. Some people even go so far as to say most published research is false. Yeah. This is a highly cited class medicine. I think this has been cited 1,500 times. And you can look at what the argument is here. I'll just go through some examples. So this is from Science. Science is one of the top journals, Science, Nature. And this was a big project to reproduce. And they looked at, I think they took 100 different studies and tried to reproduce them. Out of 100, only 30 of them were able to be reproduced. Part of the issue is there isn't much of an incentive to try to reproduce results. So we take it on faith that the researchers did it right the first time. And maybe you're thinking, well, that's psychology. Maybe there's some subjective elements to it. But even in drug target research, only 25% of 67 published drug discovery findings were reproducible. This was written by some people who worked for Big Pharma because they were realizing they were trying to take published results and finding that things weren't working. So they had to go back and redo all the experiments, which is very expensive. And then find out that, you know, 25% of them were right, the other 75% were wrong. This is really hampering the process of drug discovery. Again, this is Nature looking at cancer research. And they say only 11% of cancer research could be reproduced. Things are getting better here. You might say, okay, what about physics? So physics, how could that, I mean, maybe biology, oh, you know, it's not as hard a science as physics. That's the hardest.
Whoa.
Hey, I have a background. So there's this research about, you know, first direct evidence of plasma. This relates to the Big Bang and some experimental discoveries, supposedly. But then it came out a few months later, well, that claim was wrong. But of course, you know, even in physics, that's supposedly the most reliable of all the sciences, two big physics results, this was written a few years ago, the two big physics results, one about discovery of cosmic inflation, and then the discovery of neutrinos, have been retracted. But the initial announcements were far more attention getting, and people had already made their careers based on those things and moved on to another position.
You know, based on that statement and at the risk of injecting current events into what we're talking about here, I'd say one of the most famous examples of that would be the Wakefield study in The Lancet in 1998 about vaccines and autism, which absolutely came out to much more drama than its quiet retraction has been, and you're living through the damage of it right now.
And at the risk of being an iconoclast, some people, I'll bring up, some people, and this is in the Journal of the Royal Society, again, nothing to sneeze at. They think maybe peer review is the problem. They're like, oh, God, peer review is the way we decide everything, right? We've all been peer reviewed. But so there was a study done where they intentionally put in some errors into a paper, and some of them were like more obvious than others, and then sent it out to, I don't know how many, a lot. And only 30% of the reviewers recommended rejection for an intentionally flawed paper. So that's not so good. But this is a highlight from that paper. They said some non-reproducible preclinical papers had spawned an entire field with hundreds of secondary publications that expanded on the elements of the original observation, but did not actually seek to confirm or falsify its fundamental basis. Meaning hundreds of secondary papers, and think about how many careers go into just one paper, were based on something false. And this just basically repeats what I said. The careers, funding, positions, things that are all based on something that was false due to either fraud or let's just say bad luck had already happened. So at that point, peer review, because they'll say, oh, well, going back to the original study, this contradicts this original study. And so we have to reject it when, well, hold on, maybe you shouldn't. So then peer review becomes actively harmful, suppressing criticism. So there aren't any easy answers. I'm not trying to ruin your whole, you know, worldview here. unethical behavior distorts the reliability and credibility of science. This is just a paper in the Association of Psychological Science looking at. And getting to headline things, there's a credibility crisis in science, especially the data-heavy ones. So these are some recent headlines. Will public trust in science survive the pandemic? Science and scientists have been, when they do surveys of trust, been pretty high on the trust list, that and educators. Congress is like really low, you know, for comparison. Who knows? And then machine learning, that's one of these, you know, buzzwords. It's one of the big applications of data science. It's booming in medicine. It's also facing credibility crisis. Not sure what that's about, but that was a headline from just a little while ago. So how does this apply to you today? Some, you know, simple basic things are, you know, cheating on homework tests and written assignments. Don't do it. It starts there. You're only cheating yourself. Fulfilling work hours. When you say that you've worked a certain amount of time, you know, some of you might be on some, getting paid by the hour for work. Honest reporting of research activities. It's a big one. And then getting to the kind of scientific communication aspect that we'd like to get to in this course. Careful, transparent scientific communication, especially when data science methods are used. I'm sure we've all, well, maybe many of us have dealt with this recently in trying to talk to friends and relatives who may disagree with us about things related to the pandemic. And then also, I still believe in peer review, but you have to be really careful. You have to be honest. It's often double blind now, where you don't even know who has written the paper, and they definitely don't get to know who you are, which makes it easier to critique, but it shouldn't degenerate to the level of YouTube comments or something. So being respectful, helpful, honest critique of others' methods